How long have you been doing this modified ketogenic diet?
It sort of evolved from 2008 to 2009. I started experimenting with it because that's when I got interested in using.
And you've continued on ever since then?
Yeah, I've never really gotten out of ketosis. Yeah,
that's quite a long time.
If I did, I may have reverted back to like a low carb paleo, which is, you know, maybe up to 40 or 50% fat on or protein on some days. Yeah. So I've been a little more liberal on the protein at times, but yeah, I've been following it for a long time, and I do blood work.
Yeah, the really reason I ask is because it's the one, like I mentioned, I'm very interested in. Nutritional ketosis, which is why I'm excited to talk to you because you know so much more about it. And I'm trying to like get to the bottom. There's this conflict in my head with eating a lot of fat and its effects on the gut because, you know, I know a lot of gut researchers, a lot of my friends are looking at gut health. And one of the main things that you do to induce endotoxin, which is released from mucosal membranes, one of the main things you do to induce gut permeability is you give a high-fat diet. You feed, you know, mice, you feed, this is all done in animals, of course, which is, there's lots of problems with that, but.
And what's the typical fat source for that? Is it lard or is it?
A variety of different fat sources. Yeah. I mean, there's lard, there's corn oil. I mean, so there's, you know, there's a variety of different fat sources, but you know, fat itself, in order to be digested, you have to make these bile acids like deoxycholic acid, which you know, which causes endotoxin release. It also acts as a surfactant. I mean, it's like a detergent, you know. So, I'm not convinced that it's not, you know, not healthy, but I'm sort of trying to get to this. There's a disconnect in the literature because there's so much. Information out there showing the benefits of a ketogenic diet, nutritional ketosis.
Let me ask this question real quick. So when endotoxin is released, you know, from these bile acids, so there would be a predictable, a characteristic cytokine profile that would reflect that, right?
Yes.
And
So there's a cytokine profile and there's also you measure endotoxin in the blood, which is a very tricky thing to do because there's a lot of false positives.
Yes.
And I know someone who's trying to develop an assay to make it actually, because he's very OCD about it. And it's, so it's like, it's not out there for clinical use yet because of that reason. And even doing it in animal studies, there's a lot of researchers that don't really do it right, measuring endotoxin.
Is there any benefit to endotoxin? So when I go exercise, right, and you measure my blood and we look at, reactive oxygen species or inflammatory mediators, you could look at the blood and say, don't do that. This is not a good thing to do. Whereas, you know, if you have periodic spikes, maybe an endotoxin, is it stimulating a hormetic effect where it's enhancing my resilience or resistance to, to toxins?
Right.
Do we know that?
So endotoxin, I would say based on everything that I've known and researched and from my interactions with people that have been, you know, doing this research, it's not like reactive oxygen species where there's, you know, it's a potent signaling molecule that has this hormetic effect. It increases mitochondrial biogenesis. It increases all these genes involved in dealing with stress. You know, there's lots of benefits. You know, endotoxin released from the gut, one, it causes more VLDL production because VLDL soaks it up.
Yeah.
So that's part of the reason why inflammation, you know, is also correlated with an increase in LDL. It also binds to ApoB. It binds to the part. It binds to LDL where the LDL receptors bind, so that LDL can't be recycled as well. So it kind of prevents. There's a lot of bad things about endotoxin being released. Now I don't know. Maybe there is some sort of slight benefit from endotoxin being released. You know, I don't want to get too into the endotoxin world. I'm just saying that there is in my I'm trying to like understand in my mind how.
So you might be a little bit biased because the high fat diet work is endotoxin. I'm a little bit. I need to get educated. I mean, I understand endotoxin from kind of like a basic science point
like
of view.
Right, like sepsis bad.
from sepsis bad. But I do know, you know, when your body's challenged, even things like radiation. I mean, there's some things. You know, I don't know of any case where an autoantibody is a good thing, right? But I know most of the things that are bad out there do have some benefits. It's their, it's the level.
Absolutely.
You know, it's the level.
Dose is very important.
And the phenotype's ability to adapt to that that chemical, that stimulus is,
yeah,
is really important. Like, old people don't adapt to, you know, older phenotypes don't adapt to, you know, an oxidative stress stimulus, like,
as
robust. So I would be interested, and there's ways to simulate endotoxin, right? Experimental models, and that's something that we can do, challenge perhaps, run an experiment where we have animals on different diets, where we can challenge them and look at inflammatory cytokines. We're doing a lot of that work now.
And gut health in general, gut permeability. I would love to see
we're
some
doing
ketogenic
that too.
Research go in that direction, because there's so many unanswered questions in my mind. And there's a lot of bad data out there, like, so from the high-fat diet and the effects on the gut, because when you look at control diets and the high-fat diets, there's, well, the control diets have like 50% more fiber, and it's like, well, that's not really the same thing if you're just changing, you know, fat. So there's, you have to sift through like all sorts of crap, and it's like, I'm still, there's lots of data that you just have to throw out, but still, at the end of the day, I'm uncertain, and I'm weary about me eating a high-fat diet. Not, you know, not to mention the fact that I have certain gene polymorphisms that may not be as compatible, but because of that, because of gut health, that's my major limiting factor for me is gut health. And I would like to see more research on ketogenic diets and gut health. Like, that's something that would be, I think, is important.
How to optimize it.
Yeah. Or just what the effects are. Like, maybe they're, you know, for one, you're starving out probably a lot of the pathogenic sugar eating bacteria. So there's probably some
Without
good things going on.
Yeah.
And then there's, well, what effect does medium chain triglycerides has? Is it the same as long chain fats? Maybe not. Right. Mm-hmm. So there's, you know, different types of fat. You know, there's studies that have been coming out very recently showing the effects of polyunsaturated fat on gut, you know, biome and how it has a positive effect. So maybe if you eat, you know, certain types of fat, more of these types of fat versus the other, there's lots of things out there
undoubtedly
to be explored.
Shifts it, But I mean, getting back to your question about the ketogenic diet or a high fat diet influencing endotoxin or factors, I would think that would show up like in the literature that if some, and maybe it does, but usually a high fat diet is in the context of a high carbohydrate diet too. So that's what we don't know. When we talk about, you know, LDL particles being elevated, like even skyrocketed, LDL little p, that is only understood in the context of a high-fat diet, which is also includes sugar, like a Western diet.
Absolutely.
So we don't yet understand lipidomics and the shifts in lipid profile of the ketogenic diet. LDLP specifically, we don't understand it in the context of keto adaptation.